There's this article, it's called Economic Black Hole, 20 Reasons Why the US Economy is Dying and it simply is not going to recover. And it's quite a depressing article, and I think it's written with some kind of sadistic intent for the US, because the last reason, it says, reason number 20, when the nation practices evil, there's no way that it's going to be blessed in the long run. The truth is that we have become a nation that is dripping with corruption and wickedness from top to bottom. Unless this fundamentally changes, not even the most perfect economic policies in the world are going to do us any good. In the end, you always have what you reap, blah, 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 and it's not going to be pleasant. One of the things that I notice is the religious subtext, or let's say context, that this person writes in. Words like evil and reap what you sow and wickedness are of a religious origin. And I think it's typical, I think, for economic media that they are becoming more religiously tinted. And it's a bad thing. It's a distortion. It's an introduction of basically insanity into a public discourse or a management of public affairs. I don't think it's a good thing. But his reasons, or her reasons, because it doesn't say who is writing this, administrator, are of several types. One of them is the economy is going to go into the drain because all the mortgages are going to default, and that's going to be very bad. Only very bad for the banks that borrow the money. Nobody in the real world is affected by it, actually. If you look at the house, it's still there. The person in it is still there. The bank is still there. There's only a lot of agreements that have been made on false basis that are not going to be adhered to. But is that the price for writing out ninja loans and having option arm mortgages in the first place? And it's not affecting the real economy. It says also that the Federal Housing Commission has the plan to require upfront money for people that want to buy a house. That used to be the case, so that's the banking system that actually asking for that. That's basically to cover the margin in case of a forced execution sale of the house. It will drive the prices of houses down, which is good, because more people will be able to afford it in the depressed economy. Another, angle is that there's a lot of job loss, and I don't think that's a surprise. If you have an economy that's consumptive, then you're going to have all kinds of jobs that are completely useless, and all these jobs are going to be lost when that consumptive behavior has to be stopped. But people are flexible, they can find new jobs. There's no reason why the real economy basically, would not recover ever. Because people want to enjoy themselves, they want to have a life, so they'll find other things to do and make money. And he goes on, or she goes on, for some time. There's lots of jobs lost, there's jobs that are not registered. And he also says that states are in depression, and it's a bit mixed. But an important one, I think, is he says that, or she says that, we've been forced to participate in a global economy in which we have to compete with workers in foreign countries. Well, we don't have to compete with workers in foreign countries if we buy the stuff locally. So it's a choice. And the reason why we're basically forced, between brackets, to do that is because international business requires international banking system. And also it wastes a lot of oil, and oil has to be bought. So the oil companies can basically tax that whole activity. They cannot not tax or earn as much money on local activity because it doesn't spend so much fuel. It says, another important one, is it says 37 million Americans now receive food stamps. I think the food stamp system should be abolished as soon as possible. It's a virtual currency besides the dollar, and it's basically more reliable at the moment. But it also keeps it's a collusion between industry, GM crop manufacturers, processing plants to keep themselves in a job, and it's a bartering system, which is nice, but it shouldn't be owned by anybody. And it's basically the dream of JP Morgan, as I said in another video, because he said, "Give me control of a nation's money supply, and I care not for it, for its who makes its laws. And now JP Morgan makes the food stamps, which is basically the money supply for what it is. Let me see. Well, almost 12% of the US people. It also says here that all this employment is putting severe stress on the unemployment funds. And I think that has to do with the same jobless or the job loss story. If you give 100 people money to live and they spend it, then you're not really advancing any way. You're not making them more happy or whatever. So if you teach them to learn to do things for each other and provide services to each other, then the money you give them will actually start to circulate within the group of unemployed people, and they will no longer be unemployed. So what states need to do is allow and invent simple real services that people really need to perform for each other. And to achieve that, they have to break through all kinds of bastions of regulation for installers, for I think catering, for food processing. All kinds of rules have to be loosened. So you get a situation like you have, for instance, in Turkey, where lots of people make very delicious food for each other, where you have activity everywhere and people are pretty happy. If you go to Istanbul, there's no street in some areas, there's no street without workshops. Every house, everybody's doing something for each other. And they're all busy and they're all happy about it. So, and that has to do with the jobless situation. You simply have to approach it from a different angle. And it's not possible if all the corporate laws and all the regulations are kept in place. You don't have to abolish them, but it really they are protectionist measures. The number of Americans going broke is staggering. It's not a problem. Yes, we had, and the number 11, we had the reserve currency, and it gave us a privileged position from which the US exploited the world basically and robbed the oil from the Arabian countries. And well, if that changes, you simply have to get your own clean energy, and that's a very good plan. I won't make this video too long, but let's see. One thing I want to say here is there was an article on Reuters that Samsung invests $8.9 billion in Ontario to start a wind industry there. That's exactly what you want. You want those foreign dollars that are kept by the foreign central banks to be invested in the US in clean energy projects, because that creates a lot of jobs. It's not high tech, creates a lot of opportunity, and everybody that has renewable energy installed in his home will have less financial burden in the future. It is energy independence. That's the key to everything, because it provides countries with fertilizer, with the capability to recycle, to mold, to melt, to do everything, to run the server rooms of the internet, to fuel the planes. Everything depends on energy, and as soon as you have that energy, the sooner you have that energy for free, without having to project military power like is used to be done with Saudi Arabia, the better. And the sooner you can move to a real wealthy society, clean wealth, which is my motto. It's completely possible. See if I missed one. But this guy is pretty depressing in his assessment, and I think it's completely wrong. There's no reason why the US should be a poor country. There's no reason why it should be destitute. The only reason why it is likely, or there's let's say the trend is moving in that direction, is because the forces that make sure that happens have not been checked and have not been countered. But it's completely possible for people to do so. And the sooner they do so, I think,